How can Africa feed herself and feed the world? How can Africa become a net exporter of food rather than being a net importer of food, exporting less food than she imports? How can Africa feed herself? In fact, what are the causes of the food deficiency in Africa? Because we know that Africa has the potential to feed herself and Africa has the potential to feed the world. Africa has the largest potential for food production in the entire world because 60% of the world's arable land are in Africa. An arable land is a land that is suitable for agriculture, and Africa has about 600 million hectares of uncultivated arable land. According to the president of the African Development Bank, Akinwumi Adesina, with this capacity, Africa can feed the population of 9 billion people which we are going to have in the world by the year 2050. Yet, Africa actually imports more food than she exports. In the year 2017, Africa exported food and agricultural products to the tune of about $62 billion and imported about $64.5 billion worth of food. If the trend continues, according to Adesina, Africa will be importing food worth about $110 billion by the year 2030. Africa has about 54% of the world population in food crisis, according to the World Food Programme. Africa has over 300 million persons that are in need of food. Now let's compare the situation in Africa with America. Only 1% of the American population workforce is into agriculture. Yet, America produces about $1.9 trillion worth of food annually. 60-65% of Africa's workforce is into agriculture, yet Africa produces only about $360 billion worth of food. How can that be? What are the causes of the discrepancies? That's what we want to find out. I am Chimere. I'm an author of The Wisdom and the Power of African Unity, author of 222 Questions and Answers About African Progress. I'm the leader of One Africa Family OAF, and our vision is to lead Africans from last to first. One of the causes of lack of food sufficiency in Africa is low crop yield. Crop yield is the amount of harvest you get per piece of land, and is usually measured in tons per hectare. A ton is 1,000 kg. When you come in to check the amount of food produced in particular sectors, talking about rice or maize, in rice, you find that the African farm produces about 2 tons of rice per hectare, against the global average of about 4.2 tons per hectare. In Egypt, it is 10.04 tons per hectare. In US, 7.9 tons per hectare. In China and Japan, about 6.5 tons per hectare. Nigeria is the largest producer of cassava in the entire world, producing about 50 million metric tons of cassava. Nigeria produces only about 13.63 tons of cassava per hectare, whereas Nigeria has the capacity to produce about 40 tons of cassava per hectare. In maize, according to maize.org, the average farmland in Africa produces about 1.5 tons of maize per hectare, whereas in developed countries, they produce about 7.5 tons of maize per hectare. If Nigeria can be producing to a capacity of 40 tons of maize, of cassava per hectare, that means Nigeria is producing about 154 million tons of maize annually. If African nations can be producing, according to the global average of 4 tons of rice per hectare, that means Africa will be having double of rice production automatically. If African nations can be producing about 6.5 tons of rice per hectare, which is what is obtainable in Japan and China, that means we'll be having over 3 times the current yield of rice annually. So that is one of the problems that Africa is having in terms of food production. One of the causes of poor crop yield in African farms is that African farms are usually very tiny. For example, over 85% of farmlands in Africa are less than 2 hectares of land. Most of the farmlands we have in Africa are less than 2 acres. Whereas in the United States of America, about 80 to 85% of the farmlands in America are over 2 hectares of land. And the average size of the farmlands in America is over 180 hectares of land. There are disadvantages with smallholder farms. They cannot apply enough fertilizers to make their crops yield much. For example, in inner Africa, the average farmer applies about 10 kg of fertilizer per hectare, whereas in Asia they apply about 144 kg of fertilizer per hectare. Because of that, they produce more than farms in Africa. Smallholder farms also cannot afford irrigation. According to the UNECA, United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, according to the year, in the year 2011, African farms only had about 4% of them irrigated because most of the farms are smallholder farms and they cannot afford to irrigate the farms. Also, smallholder farms cannot easily afford to add value to their products. So the farms cannot even process the rice that they harvest from farm. So they export them, they sell them as paddy rice instead of having to process them to have rice that can be consumed immediately. So because of that, they lose a lot of value and they cannot even afford to produce more. So most of the farmers we have in Africa, especially the smallholder farmers, are illiterate. Because you know the average age of farmers in Africa is about 60 years. And the adult illiteracy rate in Africa is about 64% compared to about 99% in developed countries. And even if we then narrow it to the ages of between 50 to 55, 60 to 65, 70, we find out that the percentage will be far lower. So they cannot even afford to know more practices or ways to increase crop yield. So they maintain the old ways of producing crops. Most of these farmers make use of cutlass, hoe, shovel. In fact, in inner Africa, over 80% of the lands are cultivated using shovel, hoe, cutlass, and so on, because they cannot produce much. Only about 10% of the farmlands in Africa make use of tractors. Whereas if you go to Latin America, about 50% of the farmlands in Latin America make use of tractors. Because of that, they can produce more. Most of the farmers we have in Africa cannot afford some of the equipment needed to produce more. They cannot afford storage devices. They cannot afford all those things. And also another cause of poor productivity in Africa is lack of infrastructure. Poor road network, poor electricity supply. Just over about 14% of the rural areas in Africa are electrified. So because of that, they cannot afford to use electrical equipment to produce more. They cannot get enough information that can be helped. Another reason why Africa is not producing enough food is conflict. Conflicts in different parts of Africa are affecting food productivity across Africa. For example, conflicts in South Sudan, in Sudan, in Nigeria, in Central African Republic, they are all affecting food productivity in Africa. Take for example, Nigeria. According to the Global Terrorism Index, Nigeria is the third most terrorized country in the world and the most terrorized country in Africa. Now, Nigeria accounts for about 50% of those in need of food in the West African region. Kerexos Farm, the second largest farm, rice farm in the whole Nigeria, once almost shut down because of insecurity in Nigeria. The owner of the farm, Rotimi Williams, who was once interviewed, was talking about how insecurity led to the shutdown of the farm for a period of time. This farm is about 45,000 hectares of rice farm. So, shutting down a farm of that size, you know what the effect is going to be in the whole economy, in whole productivity. So that's why there needs to be peace in Africa for Africa to produce enough food to feed herself and to feed the entire world. So Africa must first of all have peace to have enough food. Another reason why Africa is not having food sufficiency are international policies also affecting domestic policies. Policies like subsidy, tariff, quota system, and all those systems that have been put in place by the Western nations using organizations like the IMF, World Trade Organization, and so on to bulldoze African economies have been affecting African productivity in agriculture drastically. In fact, I can rate it as the number one cause of lack of food sufficiency in Africa. For example, subsidy. What is subsidy? Subsidy is the amount of money that the government pays to a producer, maybe an agricultural, a farmer or industrialist, to be able to help him to produce more. It is the opposite of tax. In tax, the government collects money from you, making you to produce less. But in subsidy, the government gives you money so you can produce more. In subsidy, even if you produce and sell less than what you used to produce, your selling price should be less than the cost of production, the government pays you to make sure that you didn't lose anything. In fact, according to the United Nations, one of the differences between developing countries and developed countries is that developing countries tax their farmers, whereas developed countries subsidize their farmers. So developing countries collect from the farmers, while developed countries give to the farmers to produce more. In fact, every year, Western nations subsidize their farmers to the tune of about $350 billion. Because of that, they can produce more. Within the year period of the 2000, 2001, 2002, African farmers could produce a pound of cotton at about 50 cents per pound, whereas US farmers would require about 73 cents to produce a pound of cotton. Because of that, African farmers were at an advantage. But in the same year, 2002, in May 2002, President George Bush signed the US Farm Bill that subsidized US farms to the tune of about $83 billion, giving out about $1 billion cash to US farmers. That same year, the price of cotton crashed to about 35 cents. Because of that, African farmers could not make profits. Even though they were supposed to be making more profit than the West, they were making losses. Because of that, the African cotton industry crashed. African farmers lose about $250 million annually in terms of cotton production because of the Western subsidies. When the Western subsidies crash the local industry, they now flood your own local industry, our local industries in Africa, with their own cheap products and destroy our industries completely. Next thing comes food aids. Then they use IMF to destroy our own farms completely. For example, in the year 1970s, Africans were producing enough food. Africa was producing about 8% of the world total export of agriculture. But what happened? After the oil crisis of around 1973, after the Yom Kippur War, price of oil skyrocketed, many African countries were in debt. Because of that, they ran to IMF to collect loan. The IMF gave some policies which they call the SAP, Structural Adjustment Program. Among the central programs or central policies of the SAP is that you're going to remove all regulations, deregulate your export and import, produce more agricultural products and export more, remove subsidies, privatize everything. Because of that, African countries started rushing to produce more agricultural products, the same thing, rice, cereals and so on, and were exporting. Because of that, there was a glut in agricultural export. There were so many agricultural exports coming out from Africa. So the Western nations came together and started deciding the prices of those products. So African farmers were getting less than they should be getting from those products. Part also of the SAP policy given to African countries by the IMF is the deregulation of export, that Africans should remove tariffs, allow Western countries to import as much as they want to import, whereas the Western nations were keeping their own tariffs, so that when African countries import into their country, African countries do not make enough money. So with the removal of the protection of African agricultural industry, the tariffs, the Western farmers began to flood the African market with Western subsidized products. For example, the US was even exporting corn. It's exporting corn at about 20% at less cost of production, exporting wheat at less than 46% of the cost. So with this kind of deregulation, while the West are maintaining their own subsidies, Africa removed theirs. While the West maintain their own tariffs, Africa removed hers. With that, they completely destroyed the agricultural industry in Africa. In fact, according to James Wolfensohn, former president of World Bank, these Western subsidies are crippling Africa's ability to export her way out of poverty. They know that the effect of the subsidies of the West in Africa's agricultural production is very, very devastating. So with these subsidies, they are able to bulldoze African agricultural industry and make control the price of products. While also when Africa exports outside Africa, the Westerners come together, a few of them, and decide the price of African products. So with that, whether Africa is producing much or less per ton, per yield or whatever, it doesn't matter much, because after producing much, the Westerners will decide how much they're going to buy it. And if they see that you are producing more than they can control, what they do, they subsidize their own farmers and crash the price of your own product. And after that, they destroy the local industry, then flood your own local industry with their own products. By then, nothing else can hinder them. So this is how international policy has hindered Africa in terms of agriculture. And it has really affected Africa so much. Another reason why Africa is not producing much is because of some natural causes, for example, droughts, flooding, swarms of locusts and so on. drought has really affected productivity in Africa. For example, in the year 2019, the African government announced that maize yield was going to be affected by some 20% because of the drought. In the year 2014-2017, Africa lost about $372 billion to drought. Then also swarms of locusts have really affected African productivity, and that's of food. In the year 2003-2005, Africa lost about $2.5 billion worth of agriculture to swarms of locusts. Then in the year 2019-2020-2021, we're still experiencing another swarm of locusts. We have lost millions of hectares of land in Africa because of these locusts. The Ebola crisis, COVID-19, these are all natural causes which have also affected productivity in Africa. Then another cause of poor productivity in Africa is the bad leadership, corruption in Africa. For example, the roads we're supposed to have in Africa, if we had good leaders, there should be good roads all across Africa so that small farm holders can easily transport their products from one place to the other, to the market. Poor power supply is because of bad leadership. If we had good leadership, we wouldn't have been having poor power supply in this 21st century in Africa. So poor storage problems also. These are things that the government should easily provide for the people. Subsidize agriculture in Africa instead of looking for what to gain for personal use in Africa. And we know that this bad leadership is affecting every single area of Africa and in African economy, every single facet of African existence. So these are the problems. These are some of the problems. They're not all the problems, but these are the top priorities in Africa's agricultural progress. So how can Africa feed herself and not feed the world? First of all, Africa must have peace. In absence of peace, Africa cannot produce much. So we have to look for a way to bring peace to all the regions in Africa that are experiencing conflict. To that effect, we need an African parliament and we need an African army that can bring peace to Africa. The African parliament should discuss the issues going on in Africa and provide solutions and give laws that will bring those conflicts to an end. Then the African army should then enforce and bring that peace. In areas where the people have chosen to be violent, in the areas of terrorism, the African army can easily come together and bring peace to those regions in Africa. Another way to prevent conflict in Africa is to make sure that we have a conflict prevention mechanism so that we can easily have peace in the continent, make sure that we have systems that work for everybody so that there won't be any conflict. Also, the early warning system to make sure that before any conflict blows out, we can easily handle those conflicts. We don't have to wait for there to be open conflict wars before we begin to address them. We can tackle these problems even before they blow up. So that's one of the ways you can have peace in Africa. And in that peace, we can have more productivity. The farmlands that are being occupied by terrorists, we can then begin to cultivate them again. Farmers can then go to farm and produce more. And the more hectares we cultivate, the more food we produce altogether. Number two, we have to increase our crop yield. So Africa has to increase her average crop yield so that we can produce more food even with less farmland. For example, there is a system that Africa can use to produce more, because we know that as we said earlier, about 85% of African farm holders have less than 2 hectares of farm and they don't use much fertilizers. African farmers don't have so much resources to produce, to have all that you need to produce. So fortunately, there's a system on ground now known as the system of rice intensification, which was put together by a French scientist or French priest. I was resident in Madagascar around the 1980s. So the system was able to use less seed, less water, less fertilizer to produce more crops. In fact, the system of rice intensification sometimes can produce even about 10 to 15 tons of rice per hectare, as against the 2 tons of rice per hectare we talked about being produced in Africa. So you can see that if you can use that system of rice intensification in Africa for over 85% of the farmlands in Africa, so if you can be having like that 10 tons per hectare, that means Africa will be having like producing like 5 times the amount of rice being produced without even adding a single hectare of farmland. So this system of rice intensification has been applied in many countries of the world and it has been very, very tremendous. over 60 countries of the world have taken up this system, but in Africa it's still widely unknown, and experiments are going on how to get to even improve more per yield. So the system of rice intensification also has been applied to other types of crops, not only rice. For example, it's also applied in sugarcane, applied in maize, applied in different other types of crops, and the results have also been very, very tremendous. So this system of rice intensification or system of crop intensification should be used in Africa. At least let's see how much yield you can have in Africa and keep working on it to produce more. So with it, the productivity in Africa may be like up to 3 or 4 times the what we have currently in the year 2021. But another system Africa can use to improve productivity is the rice fish culture. The rice fish culture is a system that combines the production of rice together with the production of fish. So what happens is that the farmers get to spend less on insecticide because the fishes eat even the insects when they are still in the larva stage or the egg stage. So what happens is that you also have more tons of rice produced and more tons of fish produced per hectare. So this is like, and also the fishes get to fertilize the dumps for the fishes get to fertilize the farm field. So this is a system that Africa can also use to produce more. Then Africa should go for crops that have more yield. Go for the best breeds of crops that can produce more. Africans prefer natural crops to organic, inorganic crops. So there are organic crops that produce more. Africans should produce more in the African Institutes of Agriculture to have more plant yield and make them available to everybody, and keep producing more, keep crossbreeding species to get more yield per crop, the ones that will not harm the people that consume them. Also, Africans should make use of fertilizer as much as possible, as much as practicable, let me put it like that, because if we keep using the farms without applying manure, when I talk about fertilizer, I'm talking about more of manure, natural manure, without applying them to the soil, we are actually like mining the soil. It's like mining the soil and not replenishing the soil. It can actually lead to the degradation of the soil and lead to even desertification. Then another way, we have to also plant more trees to avoid losing our farmlands to desert and all those things. So we don't need too much desert. We need to reclaim as much lands as possible by planting more trees. For example, Thomas Sankara did the same thing in Burkina Faso when he was president within 1983-1987. He planted about 10 million trees in his one village, one groove policy in order to combat the desertification and have more rain and have a better environment in Africa. The Chinese also have their grain to green initiative. They have planted trees, planted crops in over 10 to 15, even about 30 million hectares of land. So we can also apply such principles, such policies to make sure that we don't lose much of our farmland to desertification. Another way to improve agriculture in Africa is policy. Africa has to renegotiate the policies that have kept Africa bound in terms of agriculture. So Africa has to approach the World Trade Organization, approach the IMF, and renegotiate the policies that are harming Africa. The West should remove those subsidies, those $350 billion subsidies, they should remove them. Africa is the one that needs to put subsidy on her agriculture. We are the ones that are disadvantaged. Africans should also have the protection, the tariffs, protecting African industry from the West and not the other way around. So Africans should have a very strong ambassador to go to IMF, go to World Bank, go to all those institutions and negotiate strongly and make sure that Africa comes up with something better, so with the best policy that can improve productivity in Africa and give Africa more foreign exchange for all her productivity. Because if Africa can even increase her share of world trade or world export in terms of agriculture, over 100 million Africans will be lifted out of poverty, and that is very mind-blowing. So Africa can improve her share of the external trade by renegotiating those policies. Go to IMF, go to World Trade Organization, go to World Bank and renegotiate those policies and come up with something that will benefit Africa, because all these policies are just like new colonialism hanging over Africa, and without removing them, Africa will be badly limited. Even after producing more, we find out that we cannot even get more from all that we produce. So we have to renegotiate those policies. Next, Africa should go for larger farmlands. For example, we said earlier that the average farmland in US is about 180 hectares of farmland. So Africa has a lot of land to cultivate and a lot of people to feed. So Africa needs to cultivate much farmland, more farmland. So, and the key to doing that is to have to plant more crops in larger amounts of land. So instead of going for 2 hectares of land, let's be going for 500 hectares, 1,000 hectares, like what Dangote is doing in Nigeria, planning to produce about 1 million tons of rice annually, cultivating hundreds of thousands of hectares of land. So that is what Africa needs, more farmlands, more mechanized farming, use of tractors, use of drones, and all that, so that we can be producing more. We can have larger farms in Africa, and with that, we can be able to cultivate more millions of hectares of farmland. When we put them all together, we'll see that we have produced more more crops than we used to produce. With that, we can also have more foreign exchange. Also, Africa must stop exporting raw materials. We must begin to add value to our agricultural products. We must stop exporting our raw materials easily to the West. We have cocoa in Africa, produced in Ivory Coast, produced in Ghana. Instead of exporting them to Switzerland, to Korea, to Japan, to build a chocolate industry and give us peanuts, and give us 2%, let us export the cocoa. Let's just move it from Ghana, move it to Ethiopia, move it to Egypt, and build processing factories all across Africa to produce chocolate products from our cocoa. From there, the $100 billion industry, Africa should be controlling at least 75% of the chocolate industry in the world, since we have about 75% of world cocoa. With that, we'll be making about $75 billion annually instead of about $2 billion annually. With $75 billion, Africa will have more than enough to produce more than enough food in this, and even begin to export to the world. And when we export to the world, we must determine the price of our agricultural exports. We will not allow the West to determine the price of our products. When we export them, we should have kind of monopsonies, duopsonies, and so on, oligopsony, to come together. If we like sell the products to like 5 companies, who would then be the ones to determine the price? When these companies then go to Europe to sell them, Europeans cannot easily manipulate the market, unlike when we have a perfect competitive market where the price can easily be manipulated. So Africa should be smart enough in selling her products. This is another way we can increase Africa's share of global export and even begin to dominate the world in terms of agriculture. Then Africa should trade within herself. Intra-African trade is not the key. It's not the key. If we have more intra-African trade, believe me, within the next few or 5 to 10 years, Africa will not even need to import even any amount of food, whether it's $1 million worth of food or so. With intra-African trade, without all these subsidies, tariffs that the West used to rob us of our foreign exchange when we export food to them, when we just move the food within Africa, we'll get a fair share, a fair payment for our agricultural products, and with that, we can use it to build Africa. Like President Paul Kagame once said, that the reason, one of the reasons why Africa is not making enough money is that Africa exports these things to the West. That if we begin to move these products around us, we have more than enough to cure poverty in Africa. So Africa must take advantage of the African Continental Free Trade Area and begin to move goods and services across Africa. When we process our products, we sell them within Africa, we sell some outside, but focus more on intra-African trade, because intra-African trade is the key, one of the keys we use to break the hedge that the West have put on us, that we cannot make enough money from our agricultural products. Because in the 1980s, Africa depended on the European market for about 60% of market for exports. So because of that, they had to control the African market and determine our price. But now, if we begin to trade within ourselves more and more, we will get a fair payment for the products that we sell within us. One of the keys that Africa must apply to have food sufficiency and even have more than enough is irrigation. Irrigation is one of the keys to the productivity in rice in Egypt. Egyptian rice fields are 100% irrigated, which is why you have about 10.04 tons on average per hectare. This is one of the ancient keys that ancient Egypt has used to have food sufficiency. And we African people, we have to apply it, because currently, as we said earlier, only 4% of farms in Africa, were irrigated as of the year 2011. So we have to make sure that we have more irrigated farms in Africa so it can produce more. Finally, African farmers need to come together. African farmers need to be educated, to be enlightened. For example, the system of rice intensification we talked about, the system of crop intensification, the rice fish system, and crossbreeding of crops to have more planting of drought resistant plants in the areas where they are drought, where there is drought. These are things that we need to come together and build a system for farmers in Africa so that these farmers all over Africa can get the information and apply them. In the absence of a system where we can reach them, nobody can help them out. They'll keep applying the old system. And also, we need to start producing our own tractors and all those equipment in Africa, and we need to start leasing them out to farmers to use. So the farmers in Africa, for example, in Ethiopia, they have the 8028 hotline where they reach out to farmers. Over 4 million farmers are part of the system. So if there's any information, they send to them to be able to intimate them on what they can do to have better crop yield, which is one of the reasons why Ethiopia's productivity is increasing rapidly. There's also the prototractor.com that integrates, finds a way to bring farmers together so that farmers can even find a way to hire or lease out their own tractors. So we need a system where farmers in Africa can be educated too. They can get the equipment they need by hiring those equipment, because they might not be able to afford them. So when we apply all these principles and do more researches to find out other ways where Africa can improve in terms of food production and make more money from her food, then Africa will be able to be a food sufficient continent, and Africa, after feeding herself, will be able to feed the entire world.